Welcome to the sixth annual League of Women Voters of Pasadena Climate Change Forum. We're very happy to have everyone here today. And I'd like to introduce League of Women Voters President Marge Nichols, who will introduce Judy Chu for her talk.
Thank you, George. It's wonderful to see everyone here today. And the League of Women Voters is primarily concerned with voting rights, money in politics, and other aspects of voter suppression. So we're also very concerned. Most leagues at the national, state, and local level have also a climate change as one of our key issues. So it's wonderful to be able to talk about that today. In the course of preparing for this forum, we were reached out to by Judy Chu's office, and we're wonderfully excited to have Judy here today to give us the latest on what's going on in Washington with regard to climate change. Judy Chu has been our representative in the House of Representatives since 2009. And she, originally met her as a United Way volunteer many years ago. And everyone has been so delighted to see her progress through the ranks of elected officials at the local level, at the school board, as mayor of Monterey Park, and then at the state assembly, and the state board of equalization before she was elected to Congress. So Judy, we're very proud of you and so happy to have you here today.
Well, it is so wonderful to be here and to see so many people coming out to a forum like this so early in the morning. And thank you, League of Women Voters, Pasadena area, for putting this together. It is so great that you're doing this kind of forum to educate the community about such an important topic. Well, I just came back from Washington, D.C. I have to tell you that all this past week, I voted against bills on the floor that were passed by Republicans to weaken the EPA. Yes. And what I want to tell you, first of all, is I respect science. I respect the brilliant minds at the Jet Propulsion Lab. And I respect their findings and the findings of scientists all around the world that climate change is real. Yes. It's clear. We are contributing to climate change, and if we don't take serious actions to reduce our carbon emissions immediately, we will jeopardize our future. And we have those same brilliant minds at JPL who've built real-time models of our Earth using satellites to track everything from changing temperatures to how quickly ice melts to the amounts of gas in the air. Despite all this overwhelming evidence, however, there are those that refuse to acknowledge this science. And most alarmingly, they are actually in charge of our country's science. It's so upside down, I just can't even believe it. The chair of the House Science, Space, and Technology Committee in Washington, D.C. is Republican Lamar Smith, an avowed climate change skeptic. In fact, they had a hearing only days ago on Wednesday, and this is what he said right at that hearing. He said, "Much of climate science today appears to be based on exaggerations, personal agendas, and questionable predictions than on scientific methods. Those who engage in such actions do a disservice to the American people and to their own profession." And so he's used his position on this committee to wage a public fight with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, because they conducted a study on climate change, and this probe is meant to send a chilling signal to the entire research community about conducting such actions. And then, just this week, employees at the U.S. Department of Energy were actually told to not use the words climate change or even emissions reduction in any written document. This all goes against the face of what we know to be real, which is that scientists have told us that an increase of just 2 degrees Celsius in the next few years will have a significant impact on people and the environment, including new health risks, threatening agriculture, and even unleashing waves of climate refugees. And so that's why I was so pleased when President Obama announced his Clean Power Plan, followed not long after by the historic Paris Agreement. These were turning points for us, and for the first time, 195 countries agreed to take responsibility to curb our emissions together. But all of that has been under constant attack since the election of Donald Trump. In the very first week, he began rolling back President Obama's climate change actions. Instead of encouraging investments in new energy, he's approved the Keystone and Dakota Access pipelines. He's risked the environmental safety of our precious lands. And despite knowing that burning coal is bad for our air and our lungs, he gave that industry a pass through his executive actions undermining the Clean Power Plan. These proposals are bad for our health, bad for our environment, and bad for our economy. But they're good for one entity, and that is the status quo energy companies. That's not right. Now, fortunately, we have a state of California. I'm so glad to see you represented today as our speakers. And thankfully, California is one of our world's largest economies. Also, of course, we have the wonderful state of New York with our Governor Andrew Cuomo. And they together announced that they are going to work together to generate half of our electricity from renewable sources by 2030. And we have people that are taking this issue seriously through mass transportation efforts like our fixed rail projects, the Gold Line, which is easing congestion on our roads. We see the growing fleet of electric cars being used by the city of Los Angeles and our Foothill Transit bus system, which is committed to ensuring that their fleet will be electric. And so we know that there were dark days, the days when smog kept us from being able to even see the San Gabriel Mountains. We can remember when acid rain created a toxic earth, but these are problems of the past thanks to our willingness to change course. So today, we need that same willingness to stop climate change. That's why in Congress, I am a member of the SEEK Caucus, the Sustainable Energy and Environmental Caucus, where we do, thank you. I can tell you this is a vigorous caucus of the Democrats where we unite as members of Congress to advocate for clean energy and to fight global warming and to vote against these worst proposals. That's why I haven't given up on the Paris Climate Agreement and why I continue to support funding for clean energy and reducing our carbon emissions. I know that together we can make a difference, and I saw it with the pulling of the horrible Trump care health care bill. If you wonder whether your voice can make a difference, just look at what happened there. Town halls galore, people pressuring these Congress members to have a town hall, and then when they had a town hall, asking them question after question, pressuring them about their vote on the health care bill, and it really was the pressure that caused the Republicans to pull that bill. So I see that as a triumph, and on these critical issues, our voices count just as much. So let's make sure we raise our voices all across this country about our priorities and about saving this planet. I am so glad to see you here. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of this important conversation.
If you look there on the agenda, the forum procedures, I really am not going to make much of an announcement about it. We will follow our usual procedure to, after each, when you're listening to the speech, hold your questions until after the speech, and then there will be a question and answer. We will have you lining up in the center aisle behind the projection table, and it's kind of first come, first served. We are not filtering questions, but we want them to be brief, and we're not asking for speeches, we're asking for questions. So you can frame your question, but don't make a speech, okay? That's all we need really to say about that. So we're ready to begin the main part of our program. Our first speaker is LaRonda Bowen, who is she's ombudsman of the California Air Resources Board. She has over 25 years of experience as a communications professional and has served as an advisor to the US EPA. She has helped to shape federal, state, and local policy. She's published environment-related articles and spoken to over 200 groups and organizations. She will speak about meeting California's SB 32 emission goals in an age of federal policy uncertainty. LaRonda?
You to advance them. So thank you, George. Thank you for having me. It's an honor to be here. I'm going to tell you right up front, I'm a bit technology challenged. That gentleman sitting in the purple shirt there is my husband. His name is Scott Fruin. He's an excellent with technology. I have the little whatever the thing is, but I'm not quite sure how to turn it on. So I'm just going to ask you to advance each thing. All right. So I want to just appreciate what our legislator said, because she set the stage. I mentioned to her, I couldn't have done it any better myself. I couldn't have asked for a better setup. I have been to her office in DC representing the Air Resources Board, and I want to tell you that you couldn't be better represented. Our interests couldn't be better represented, and we couldn't have a more responsive legislator whatever issues you're bringing. I'm always bringing things related to typically small business and environment, climate change always being one of them, energy and the policies of the state of California, but specifically to our agency. So I just want to thank you for that, and thank your team and thank your staff for their support. Even when you're there, your LA team is working for you. All right. So slide. So we're going to talk about greenhouse gas legislation today. So in the Air Resources Board, we focus a lot on mobile sources. But just so when you hear us talk about it, are we going to back up from climate change? Anybody ever want that question? Shall we just get it right out on the floor in the first place? Is California going to back away from clean air and climate pollutant reduction?
No.
Thank you. So this is just out. It's clear. All right. So now we're starting there. Now, how come that's true and how does it look? What does it look like? So when we talk about all of these different strategies that we have for criteria pollutants, the state implementation plan, we already have in law and in policy and in practice tools, resources, and history of reducing air pollution. So that we had that before there was a requirement through the Clean Air Act. So we had we have the waivers that you hear about. You hear about those in the news now. Oh, they're going to take away the waivers. The waivers were permission given to California to be more stringent than the federal regulations because we already were making progress in areas where the rest of the country hadn't even thought about the need, much less making any progress. So we have those waivers. We can be more stringent. We can do things that other states can't do, but we had the worst problem. We had smog where people were. I'm a native Angeleno, and you guys are going to hear from Ed later, but I didn't know that I was going to grow up and have, well, Ed's going to tell you. I'm not going to tell you what, he's going to tell you what I have. But When I was a kindergartner, my girlfriend and I would sit on the edge of the sandbox. We would rub our eyes because they stung. We didn't know they were stinging because of air pollution. We just thought they stung. So we'd rub our eyes, and when you rubbed your eyes, it would ease that stinging, but it would make tears. Somebody else said, and a few of you. Well, we thought it was so fun. We would do that, and then whoever had the most, made the most tears, they won. It was a game. All right. So we didn't know that there were lung issues associated with that. We have the air toxics reduction programs. We're focusing on large and small sources. Diesel particulate, it's an air toxic, not just a climate forcing issue. ARB, we are constantly re-evaluating our regulations in terms of the Office of Health Hazard Assessment. Climate change emissions, we have state legislation before there was federal legislation. Get that? We had state legislation. We still do. We still do. AB 32 didn't go away when SB 32 came on. SB 32 strengthened AB 32 by making it giving us standing to go beyond 2030. All right. So right now, I'm going to use for today the scoping plan as sort of a guideline, because the scoping plan is a document that the Air Resources Board and the State of California use to organize how we're going to move. What is our strategy? What is our plan of action? Who's going to do what? The great thing about AB 32 is it brought together state agencies across the board. It brought together the energy, the air, the water, the waste, the transportation sectors, the planning department, and brought all these organizations together. Now, I told you I've been in this business a long time, or at least George told you that. One of the big questions, the big problems I heard and faced for years and years from the business community was, how come the state agencies don't talk to each other? There was no answer. AB 32 solved that problem. It solved the problem, and it brought in our state what I don't think the people at the federal level outside of California understand. It brought a cohesiveness. It brought a planning platform. It brought a way of linking our programs, our people, our resources together, and planning for the future of our state. Planning not just for this generation, but for future generations. That's part of the strength of AB 32, and I think it's a completely undervalued, underestimated strength of California, as you guys have already demonstrated. So we're going to go to the next slide. This is Jenna Latt. She works at the Air Resources Board, and she's excited. All right, so greenhouse gas legislation. AB 32, when that legislation, and to me, of all the legislation I've read over the years, it's one of the best crafted bills I have ever read. Really well thought out. And it says, why do we need a climate program? Because climate change is a serious threat to our economic well-being, to our public health, to our natural resources. A serious threat. This is 2006, you guys, when this bill was passed. So you know that it was in the making a couple years before that, right? Climate change will have a detrimental effect on California's largest industries, agriculture. Our ag sector feeds much of the world, not just California, not just the United States, but much of the world. So if our agricultural sector falls down, hunger occurs, real hunger. Anybody here ever put a salt thing under their tongue and tighten their belt? I have, okay? Salt helps you not be so hungry. Tighten your belt, you don't feel it. That's not how we don't want to go back. We want to go forward. It will increase strain on our electricity sector and on our water supply. So we're in Southern California. Where does most of the rain fall? Where does the snowpack happen? So then how do we get all of that water over the Tehachapis, for example? Electricity, water pumps. So if we have drought, if we have extreme heat, which we already know are outcomes of climate change, where are we going to get that water? And what's it going to cost us to get it so that we can water our grass? Well, okay, so we don't water the grass. How about take a shower? Okay, well, we just do sponge baths. How about drink water? We buy bottled water? I don't think so. All right. So because California had issues and because California had leadership, Leadership matters, you guys. So because we had leadership, we have what is our role? We have a worldwide role. We're doing what we need to do, but other people are watching. We also learn from what other people are doing. We looked at Europe. We looked at what's happening in other parts of the world. And people flock here to come and see what's happening in California. What are your technologies? What is your universities doing? We want to stay and spend time with you.
Okay,
next. So we have clean vehicles and many things. The whole world is looking at us for action. So AB 32 said that we would get greenhouse gas emissions back to 20. By 2020, we would get greenhouse gas emissions back to the 1990 levels. SB 32 said we will extend those goals all the way to 2030. So AB 32 was first, and SB 32 was the more recent one. So SB 32 also said we'll reduce our greenhouse gas emissions by 40% over 1990 levels. So you see that we're making the steady progress? That's the idea. And then a companion piece to SB 32, do come in. To SB 32 was that we would consider the social costs of greenhouse gas reductions, prioritize direct emissions, and continue to put forward all the activities and requirements of AB 32. All right. So now we're going to go to the next slide. Now we're going to talk a little bit about where we are and where we've been. So we're looking at the greenhouse gas emission reductions by sector. The transportation sector is the largest area. So we're going to focus most of our talk today just on the transportation sector, but it's not the only sector. So transportation includes how we move ourselves around from place to place, how we move outside of our local area, so how much flying do you do, how do you travel, do you walk, do you bike, can you walk or bike? Now you can take the Gold Line, you can take a lot of electric transit, right? Yes. You can take a lot of public transit now that we didn't have. Many transportation options, new business models are emerging. Who's one of the most creative sectors in our entire economy all over the world? Our small business folks. Do you know that? Does everybody already know that? You don't think about it? Think about it from now on. So for the rest of this presentation, I want you to think in your mind what small businesses came or are developing or could be developed that will provide economic benefits, that will provide jobs, that will provide healthy, strong communities. What's the fastest way out of poverty? Two steps, right? Education and entrepreneurship. That's it. That's what they are. So think about that. And if you drive through Temple City, you see so many small businesses and so many entrepreneurs here in Pasadena. You can walk up and down the street here, patronize those folks, talk to them, see what they're doing. So, okay, that's my plug for small business. Anyway, that my heart lives there. People that know me will tell you that. So as we look at the sectors where the emissions are occurring, you can think about what you're doing now and what you can do differently. But you can also notice something. There are sectors that are being affected by the current leadership that we have in the White House. So reducing transportation emissions means more electrification, more zero emission vehicles, alternative fuels. So when we think about fuel cells, you know, we're basically moving away from a fossil-fueled primary way of getting around. Well, we have been tied. Our economic growth was tied. Our industrial growth was tied. Our ability to move from place to place was tied to the oil industry. What, pretty much since the Industrial Revolution, right? Really, all the way back to Rockefeller. So when you think about the money that's in that sector, it's no surprise that there's pushback, because if I reach into your pocket and take his money out of his pocket, most people aren't going to be so willing. It's because his pocket was empty. Right?
Thank you.
So that's what's happening. We're taking money out of one pocket, and we're putting it in other pockets. And that makes people uncomfortable and unhappy. So one of the things that happened just before Paris, and that happened, was intensified at Paris, was the investor community saying, we are disinvesting. Many investor companies, members of that community, we're disinvesting from fossil fuels. We're not putting our money there anymore. We're looking for alternatives. Okay? So they deserve a hand, right? They deserve a hand. So that made people pretty nervous. So you can see the industrial sector, electric power, you know, those are big things. You can work on the commercial and residential, your own house. You can use different kinds of lighting. You can use less water. There are many things you can do. You can go on the Cool California, Cool, C-O-O-L, California, like it's California, .org, coolcalifornia.org website. And there are several different tabs there, but you can look and see what small businesses have done. We've got a lot of case studies on there. You can apply those very same tools to your home. There's a carbon calculator. You can see what your carbon footprint is. You can see how to reduce it. There's information on there, a funding wizard, how do you pay for things. And you can build a little ecosystem in your own community that is as close to low carbon as you can get. And you can continue to do that. So just use the tools. All of us can reduce something in these sectors. Now, how many of you look for things that are bought nearby, that are made locally? When you go shopping? Yeah, good go, what a group. That's pretty cool, yes. And so avoid things that have to travel halfway across the world to get here, right? Find a tailor that can make things that fit you. I know I have that problem. find things that work. But think about these sectors and ask yourself constantly, what am I doing? What little thing could I do differently? And when you do it differently, the person next to you will do it differently, somebody else in your community, your kids, your grandkids, your cousins, your relatives, you know, they'll do something different too. They may think you're crazy, they probably will, probably talk bad about you for a while. You'll survive, I promise. Okay, so commitment here. Will you commit to do one thing differently by a show of hands? Make up your mind. Don't raise your hand if you're not going to do it. One thing differently. Just one. Okay. So, George, next year, you're going to ask them, what did they do differently? And what difference did it make, right? Okay, next slide. So we look at the greenhouse gas emission reduction targets that we have over the years. So in 1990, the GHG levels were 431 million metric tons approximately. Okay? AB 32... with that alone, we're on track to meet or really exceed our 2020 target. That means we'll be back to the 1990 levels by 2020. We don't see any problem with that, just from the steps that we've taken already. So if the world crashed and California had no money, nothing, we would still meet those targets. Understand? So what's happening at the federal level won't affect that. So what you guys do will have more impact than what anybody else does. All right. SB 32 codifies the 2030 goals. Do you guys remember Governor Brown's January 2015 inaugural address? And he talked about these pillars. We're going to reduce our use of petroleum by 50%. We're going to have cleaner, increase our use of renewables by 50%, those pillars. Well, those got codified into SB 32. So we'll stay on track right now to meet those goals. If and when we meet the 2030 goals, we will be very much on track for meeting the 2050 goals. That was an 80% reduction over 1990. Pretty good for one state. How are we doing this? Lots of new technologies. In the vehicle sector, in the transportation sector, completely transforming the way we move ourselves and products. You saw what a big part that plays. Transforming the electricity sector. The work that you guys are all doing to reduce your use of water, to reduce waste, to just conserve everything. The fact that you're changing the way that you get around. The fact that you're doing much more local shopping and much more local work. That makes a difference. So when we meet the 2030 goals, we will be on track for 2050. If we meet 2050, we can do this, you guys. when we meet 2050, somebody corrected me, thank you, when we meet 2050 goals, this will put us in line with the scientifically established levels needed in the United States to limit global warming below 2 degrees Celsius. This will put us on track. This will put us on track. Keep that in your mind. This will put us on track. If California is on track, hey, you know there's midterm elections coming up. You have a chance here, right? So think about what you want, what you are committed to, and what you can do differently to make the changes that you need to make in your own life, but also to influence others to make changes in theirs. And we can get there. We're not so far away. If California can do it, anybody can do it. We have all so much more population. We also have a lot of resources, absolutely. But we have a lot of partners, too. We have the 177 states. These are states, a lot of them in the Northeast, who have agreed to have zero-emission vehicles. We have transportation infrastructure right here in Los Angeles. We have the number three in the entire world, small business incubator. And then because the other number one and number two are not clean technology incubators, that means in Los Angeles, we have the number one in the world clean technology incubator. Those folks are over there. They're so excited. We connected them with the policymakers, and they're thinking about a Mobi. You can charge your electric vehicle. There's a little thing literally called a Mobi. It's just a little tow charger. So you can be parked in a parking lot, and you don't have to worry about being, oh, am I the only one that can get in that little space? We have another company that envisions solar. They have a solar charger that parks somewhere. It's charging from the sun. That's making the electricity. You plug in, and so you're basically plugged into the sun. Right? I mean, there's so much. I'm telling you, we can do this. There didn't used to be whiteout. There didn't used to be safety pins. You know what I mean? We can do this. We can do this. All right. So we're getting there. All right, next slide. I told you that the scoping plan is the tool that the Air Resources Board uses for planning where we are and where we're going. So this is short-lived climate pollutants, mobile source strategy, energy efficiency, reducing emissions from refineries, the low-carbon fuel standard, which is reformulating the gasoline, the liquid fuel. We're going to have liquid fuel for a long time. We're getting there. We can get there. And so these are some of the strategies. Now, scoping plan is under development now. AB 32 required us to do it every 5 years to review where we were. So this is that time. The next plan will go, it's been extended, so I think it'll go in the June, it's the June meeting of this year. So go online, Air Resources Board, California Air Resources Board, homepage, and then there's a little bar on the right-hand side at the top. You can type in anything. So if you type in scoping plan, it'll come up. If you type in AB 32, you'll get a whole page of things. If you type in SB 32, you'll get a lot. Mobile sources, fuel, whatever you want to type in. All of the work we're doing is connected to reducing the emissions that contribute to climate change. So there's nothing wasted here in the state of California. Okay, next. So we've had 15 public workshops so far on this. The Environmental Justice Advisory Committee is a committee that's made out of EJ communities and low-income communities. They have very good workshops. If you know, you get tired of all the technical jargon and you want something in plain English, look for the EJ workshops and listen to them. Sometimes they're broadcast, and occasionally they're here in the Los Angeles area. We're working with many, many state agencies. So that's, as I mentioned at the beginning, a critical part of this whole thing. So the next slide. So we've had a couple meetings on the draft scoping plan. The whole scoping plan draft is available on our website. It was an informational item, some more workshops coming up, and it is going to come to the June board meeting. So it's not too late. What I'm trying to tell you is it's not too late to take a look at that scoping plan. It's divided into sectors, so the ag sector, the working land sector, transportation sector, et cetera, all waste, water, whatever you're interested in. If you're just interested in water, there's a water section. If you're just interested in transportation, there's a transportation sector, like that, okay? So you'll find what you want. All right, so we're moving ahead. That's all, I just want you to know that, we're moving ahead. Again, we're not backing off, all right? Next slide. And how, in addition to these things that we were doing anyway, right? There's so many, I can't tell you everything, so I told you just I'm using a couple of pieces. I'm sticking here with the transportation sector. So the zero emission vehicles, 450,000 zero emission vehicles and plug-in hybrid electric vehicles sold in the US so far. 450,000 from how many? Zero, right? The electric car, the idea for the electric car is a very simple vehicle. Even I can figure out how it works. It's a very simple vehicle. It's a box, the thing that you're in, and a battery, and it's hooked up. That's it. When the Ford Motor Company was developing its first car was an electric vehicle. And the women liked the electric vehicle because it was easy, it was simple, and it was clean. But the men got together and decided gasoline was better. So we had the combustion engine, and we've been on it ever since. So anyway, we're getting back, ladies, we're getting back to where we should have been. All right, not that the air pollution problem is the fault of the guys, I'm teasing you guys. 2 million battery electric vehicles and plug-in electric vehicles were expected at the end of 2016. I think we're probably there, we haven't done the look back yet. We are expanding these clean, no emission technologies to the heavy duty freight sector, heavy duty trucks, and also to light and medium duty trucks, yes. This is where the federal money does matter, okay? This is where it does matter because I told you I'm an advocate for small business. If you're a truck owner operator and that's your livelihood, that's all you can do and a new truck costs more than you make, you need a loan. You need some kind of incentives, you need some assistance, and so we have to work through those kinds of issues. Additionally, fast charging stations. So the people that have electric vehicles have one complaint, it takes too long to charge and the range is too small. So even though the range is 200 miles and the average trip is 7, people think the range is too small. So fast charging and more charging stations, right? So there are many choices in the zero emission vehicles. I don't want to overlook the fuel cell vehicles. Anybody here drive a Toyota Mirai? Or have seen that? Okay, that's what my boss drives right now. She'll try every new vehicle and she likes her Mirai. She likes all of them. The Toyota folks have decided, you know, liquid fuel gets rid of that range anxiety. People can fuel up. And so hydrogen fueling stations are popping up everywhere. And that's part of the infrastructure, so that you as a Californian, you wherever you live in the country, you'll have choice, just more choices than you have now. You won't just have to have an oil-based car. You can have a fuel cell car. You can still have a gasoline-based car. It could be ethanol or some other kind of fuel made out of your waste grease from McDonald's. There is a small business company in San Diego that I went to see. And they have trucks that come in, and they're loaded. They look like the oil tank trucks that we're used to seeing on the freeway, but they only have food-grade oil in there. And they take that and make a biofuel out of it and send it right back out. So there you go, industry developing all over the place. This is a really exciting time. I call it the second industrial revolution. My technology developer friends say, no, LaRonda, it's the third. The second was the computer, so maybe. For me, it's the second. All right. You guys have also heard about the VW settlement, anybody? Yeah, it's been in the news a lot. All right, so it's a lot of money. Just put it that way. $800 million of investment money will come to California. I think it's over 10 years. It is over 10 years. And I want to be real clear, ARB, California Air Resources Board, does not get that money. It's not coming to us to do everything with. But it is worked out through Air Resources Board provided information on how we would like to see that money used, the court settle everything, and so we're going to have that money in California to actually clean up the vehicle fleet. So we wanted zero emission vehicle infrastructure. So there's charging stations for electric vehicles, and it's a possibility that Volkswagen will begin to develop electric vehicles. And so you'll hear some controversy about should they be allowed to use their money to put in electric vehicle charging if they then become electric vehicle manufacturers, blah, all that stuff. Doesn't matter. We need the infrastructure, right? So if we get the infrastructure, let the vehicles come. That's what we want. We're not going to have time to be petty about stuff. You can look on our website there, that website address. You can type in VW settlement and you'll get more detail. There's another $381 million that will go to mitigate NOx emissions. We don't have all the details about these settlements because it is being worked out through the courts. But that's not the whole picture. There's quite a bit more money. $1.2 billion with a B. Dollars outside of California, because California is not the only place where those vehicles were sold. So the reason for the you guys, quick summary of what happened, we have emission standards, all the auto companies have to meet them. If they cheat, I'm going to use that word, I don't know another word to use, I don't know a nicer word to use, so there's a penalty for that, okay? So it came to light in great part, in large part, due to the work of the Air Resources Board laboratory staff, and they were honored for their work at our board meeting earlier this month, that there was a defeat device on the Volkswagen vehicles. So when you went in for smog check, the vehicle could tell you were having smog check. They could tell that you were on a machine and not doing your regular driving. And so it gave you different readouts. So for years and years, it also isn't unique. Well, cheating, you may hear more stories about it. Let's just put it that way. So the air districts, South Coast and other air districts, for a long time, have wondered why the emissions inventory didn't match, you know, what they were actually experiencing, what they were actually measuring in the air. And then the Air Resources Board technology team wondered why the performance of the vehicles on the machines, the testing machines, didn't, well, just, one and one was not making two, so that's how that came about. That's LaRonda's short summary. All right. It was excellent work by everyone, and so the team was so proud. If you guys could have been at our board meeting in Riverside a week ago, to see how proud our staff was to be recognized for the work they did, how committed they really, really are to cleaning up the air. Every last one of them. There is no question that the people at the laboratory in El Monte are some of the most dedicated public servants, you know, that you're gonna find. Okay, next. So bottom line, we are moving forward. We have many partners. There's the under two MOU, which Judy Chu referred to briefly when she said all 167 partners that joined us in Paris. 167 jurisdictions representing 33 countries and 6 continents. Can you stop climate change? The part of it that's related to human activity? Yes. It takes humans to do it. It takes humans to stop it. One human didn't create it. One human can't stop it. A whole Congress of humans can't stop it. Just know that, the power that you have. And you're connected all around the globe, all around the world. So I just want you to know that. The Under Two forms the Under Two Coalition, which represents more than 1.9 billion people and 25.9 trillion dollars in gross domestic products. So you could just stand up proud, would you please? Just know, we're gonna do this. You know, it's like when you were a kid and your mom said, you can't climb that tree, and you said, yes, I can, right? And you did it, it's the same. There's also the Warsaw International Mechanism for Loss and Damage that's associated with climate change. and that's run through the United Nations. There is a People's Climate March to Washington coming up on April 29th. So were some of you at the Women's March, and some of you are going to? All right, same organizers, right? Same organizers, all right. A way to keep up with some of the work that's going on is Moyer and Company, M-O-Y-E-R-S, Newscaster formerly, and Company website. There are many private organizations that are also working globally on climate change, working domestically. The League of Women Voters, who has a place in my heart forever. This organization has so much power, so much credibility, so much respect. You guys can do a lot. You can move mountains. You want to organize more than ever, not just here, but across the country on behalf of this issue. It really does matter to the next generation. I was giving a talk a few years ago in San Diego, and a man said to me, I don't care what happens about climate change. My mother's dead, my father's dead. I don't have any children. I'm gonna make as much greenhouse gas emissions as I can before I die. And I'll always remember that, because that was his point of view. So that point of view, okay, what are you gonna do? It's an individual commitment. But if you feel passionately on the opposite, then that too is an individual commitment. So there are students, there are artists, there are churches, there are independent multimillionaires and billionaires. There's the LA Clean Tech Incubator, there's Small Business Innovators, there's the Innovation Hubs throughout the state of California. You can find all of those on the website of the Governor's Office of Business, GoBiz, G-O-B-I-Z. And there's individuals like you taking local action, so we can get there. Last slide. It's your turn. Thank you. Special thanks to my wonderful husband. So 50%, 80% is for 2050. When we get to 2050, we're at 80% below the 1990 use. We can do that. Hey, welcome. Fine.
What is the status of the cap and trade program?
So cap and trade is it is still under discussion. How do we proceed? Do we continue? What happens with the revenue? All of those issues. And it is really, really very sensitive right now, so I can't go into a discussion. But as soon as there's a clarity, I'll send George an email. Yeah? And then you can get it out to everybody? Or if you want to reach me personally, you can. Yeah, yeah. Jenna was reminding me it's still being workshopped. It's going, yeah. I don't know when the next meeting is, do you?
There was one on Wednesday, I think.
Jenna's saying there's one on Wednesday. No, was one last Wednesday, but I don't know if there's a next one. We'll come back and if there is. But it's a very, as you imagine, when there's a lot of money at stake, everybody wants to use it a certain way. Do you have cap and trade? The whole idea of trading pollutants is uncomfortable for many people, because they assume that trading means I'm going to trade, you're going to give me money, and then you're going to continue to pollute, and you're going to just continue to give me money and continue to pollute. And there's not a very clear understanding that those emissions have to come down. It's cap and trade. It's not just trade forever. But that those revenues can be used in ways that are very constructive. So that's sort of the nature of the argument, of the debate, and then how the money gets used. Madam in the beautiful blue.
Hi. I did take the nasty, smelly Metrolink train off to Riverside last Friday, and I watched the first day of the
wonderful
events. And I was really, really horrified by all the people who live in San Bernardino and Riverside.
So the question is really, as I'm hearing it, how do we speed up the transition to a cleaner truck fleet? The truck fleet is significantly cleaner now than it's ever been, as you know, no doubt. And we have diesel particulate filters on most of the trucks that travel the highways. Is it enough? No. Is it Is it significantly better than it was? Yes. And we are continuing to move forward. But these transitions are expensive, and the technology has to work in every application. So much, as this speaker pointed out, so much of our goods and services come by truck, that if we didn't have those trucks on the road, then there would be other kinds of problems. You would be saying, I can't get any groceries, I can't get my, you know, so the everything comes by truck, even if it's packages now, right? So we have gone to a more mobile society at a time when we recognize the health effects of diesel particulate and ultrafine particles. So cleaning up the fleet is definitely a high priority. And it is a high priority at the Air Resources Board and also within the state. So that, but we have thousands and thousands and thousands of trucks. So cleaning them all up to the same standard all at one time, that won't happen. It hasn't happened. But continuing to turn them over as rapidly as possible and to deploy the cleanest trucks in the busiest corridors. So it's not just what's on the road, but where on the road are those vehicles. And so the Air Resources Board and others have worked together to try and deploy the cleanest fleets, the lowest emitting vehicles in the high traffic corridors. So bringing goods, that we call it the goods movement, but in those major corridors. There is still a lot of pollution, but it's just so much more, it's kind of like looking outside. It's so much cleaner than it has been in the past. So hope that helps you. Yeah. There's a lot of funding program. I mean, built millions and millions of dollars. I didn't bring the number, but we've spent a lot of money to clean up the trucks, and we'll continue to do that. Incentive programs, businesses spending their own money. It's just taking time because there's so many out there.
Hi. Thank you for your comments and your enthusiasm.
Thank you. Thank you.
I went to an EJAC meeting, EJAC Environmental
Justice Advisory Council. Yes.
And I heard a presentation from CARB, and it seems that they're just hell-bent on going forward with cap and trade.
So the question is, why don't we consider more thoroughly a cap and tax, I'm sorry, a carbon tax program? I think in the...
cap and tax, that was another
one. Yeah. So there were three or four scenarios that the Air Resources Board analyzed to look at, to compare. How do we achieve our emissions reduction goals? How do we do it in the most cost-effective way? And how do we retain the flexibility that we need in our economy? I'm not an economist, so I can't tell you. I have never heard at our agency that we have made up our mind there's only one way to get there. I've never heard that. I've been there 6 years. So I think that I have to believe that our staff is convinced by the evidence and their needs that cap and trade is still a really viable way to get there. I don't know. But you can follow up separately, and I'll put you in touch with our economist if you like.
Okay.
Hi, I just have two brief questions. One, the status of the GOLA train from LA to San Francisco, is that still going forward?
As far as I know, it is. I see Vickery nodding yes. I haven't heard that it isn't. Boy, what a great question. How do we support our legislators, Judy Chu and others, in dealing with the voter suppression problems? I mean, I think you do the things this organization does. I'm not speaking on this topic as part of the Air Resources Board because it's not on my, I can't. But personally, I think that what's great about the League of Women Voters is you organize, you educate, you know, you can connect with Project Vote Smart. That's another entity that you can work through. They're nonpartisan, they're voter education group. You guys could be great ambassadors to help educate voters and demand, as Judy Chu said, you have to demand from your legislators what you want and need, and you want them to continue to stand strong. But she pointed out something very important that I hope everybody got, which was the organization that happened across the country. Republicans, Democrats, everybody organized town hall meetings, held their legislators accountable. The legislators have one thing they want to do, get reelected. And if their constituents are saying that we're not going to elect you if you don't solve this problem, it changes their thinking. So use your networks, really use them, really use your organization skills. Prioritize what you want and set those groups and find partners and work on it. You can get it done. Welcome. Hello, Vickery. Thank you, Vickery. That's very sweet. She's a delight to work with. Thank you. Yeah. Hal, this is a vital question. Now, you see, I didn't think anybody was going to ask it, but I had in my mind when I saw you, this, if anybody was going to ask this question, it will be this lady. How much do we get in federal money, bottom line, to support climate change? We have 5 minutes left. Much of the support that California gets from the federal government, from the US EPA, it's not labeled climate change, but it comes to the local air districts, for example. That's one of the things that may be cut. The local air districts provide programs that help with all the pollutants, as we discussed earlier. So they're looking to cut those. The money we get for transportation, how we spend that money is our choice, and we spend it on public transit a lot, not just highway repair, not just things that encourage more use of automobiles. So as the feds go after specific parts of the budget that get subvened, sent to the states, if you pay attention, you'll see that they're hitting transportation funds of the agencies, they're hitting the energy funds, they're hitting the EPA, so the agencies, the research, there was a big thing the other day on research, they're looking at, in my view, I'm not there so I don't know, but as I look at it as a citizen, it seems to me that there's a concerted effort to find out where funds go to various programs that could be reduced or redirected. So the real question is, does that prevent California? No, it hinders us. If we don't have the federal funding, because we often do match, federal funds match something that we're doing, doesn't stop us. Doesn't stop us.
I'm Marilyn Weilander, and
I'm excited about that. This is the question. Do other countries get discouraged by what's happening in the U.S.? I think they probably get frustrated. I don't think it's going to stop anybody. Again, the world understands that climate is changing. They're just not confused. And so whether we protect our people or not is somewhat irrelevant to many other countries. We have visitors coming to the Air Resources Board and to California, as I mentioned earlier, from everywhere, trying to see what we're doing and emulate what we're doing. So I think it's more of a hiccup and less of a, I mean, sometimes it takes people a while to really sit down and figure out these things are real. So, okay. We move pretty fast, California. So you heard of don't leave any child behind? It's sort of like that. We move very fast and we may have left some people behind. They will catch up, my belief. There was a pie chart that had the different, yeah. So the question is, that's a very good suggestion and I'll take it that way. We don't have it broken down, but we should. And the transportation sector covers goods movement sector. Okay, so things that go by ship and come in, and they get on rail or they get on truck, they're covered. But I'll give you my card and we can follow up,
this
okay?
This will have to be the last questioner.
Yes, the last question. Okay, we have 30 seconds left, so we have, yeah. If you have, I can talk to you separately, is that okay?
Sure, this is, you're talking about, places to plug your car in.
Mm-hmm. It's a great idea. I haven't heard it, and I don't know. Perfect place to end. Thank you. I'm sorry, sir. I will catch you separately, yes?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, LaRonda.